It's time for Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness, powered by the staff at Race Chaser Online. Today's racing news, yesterday's racing history, and now here are your hosts, Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
Good evening, race fans, and welcome to a brand new edition of Monday Night Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. It is Motorsports Madness. I'm Jacob Seelman alongside my two colleagues every week here at the roundtable, Tom Baker and Kyle Magda, as we get set to bring you through the wild and wacky world that has been the weekend in motorsports, whether it's news, views, or it's all about craziness. We've got it here on the Madness, and we certainly have a lot to talk about over the next 2 hours. Got a couple of driver guests from the NASCAR short track ranks moving their way up for 2015 that we'll talk to a little bit later on in the show. Got some dirt, got some open wheel on the horizon. It's going to be fun, but we start with our top story tonight, and I'll go over to my left to our Race Chaser Online senior editor, Tom Baker. And Tom, I was as blown away as you were this morning when we popped up on our little website there that some guy's making a few headlines, and you know what? It's six letters long. Junior!
Or it could just be two in a period, if you wanted it to be.
Yeah, well, it could be. And you know what? It's not just the fact that it is Junior. It's the fact that, hey, boys, Junior's going truck racing.
Yeah, how cool is that? I mean, that's that was a real surprise. I don't think anyone saw that coming, other than the parties involved. But, you know, Dale Junior has never been afraid to go in any and all directions with his team. I mean, he's had the late models. Obviously, they've been in the Nationwide now Xfinity series. And no one ever said they would never go truck racing. They just hadn't done it. And I think the opportunity was there. It seems like a kind of a logical thing to do. You have Cole Custer, who's in the Stuart Haas family, so to speak, because of his father Joe Custer, and pardon me, I think Cole is the perfect fit for this type of a program. I think it's logical if you're going to try and stay within that big old family, either Stuart Haas has to do the truck program, or you know, or Hendrick or Junior. So it doesn't really matter which label you put on it; it's all part and parcel of the same big family. And I think for Junior Motorsports to go in this direction opens up some things for them for later on to maybe expand that from one driver to multiple drivers down the road or whatever. And it certainly adds, I think, a much needed bit of spice to the truck series to have that brand involved in the program for 2015. Kyle Magda, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, guys, thanks for having me on tonight, and good night, and good evening, everybody. What a pickup for Junior Motorsports. I did not expect this at all. I thought maybe that with Turner Scott, of course, folding, didn't really help Cole Custer that much. But, you know, with Junior Motorsports, what Dale Junior wants to do, and I think this is a great pickup. And then I know you and I were talking, Jacob, about Austin Theriault as well. He, you know, his plans are still going to be announced, and I think it was an article in a Bangor Maine newspaper today. So there's a lot of things still on the table for that. But for Cole Custer, I mean, from what I was reading in the deal, it's going to be 10 truck races and then select Can-Am races and ARCA races as well. And guys, Cole Custer turns 17 on January 23rd, and that means he'll be old enough to run the ARCA events at Pocono and Kentucky, since those tracks both allow 17-year-old drivers to run. So I think, you know, for Cole Custer, that would be a valuable experience for him to gain.
It would be, and I can see, Kyle, exactly how flustered in the head you are over this. So we're not disappearing just quite as quick as we came.
Yeah, there's just so much to the deal. And then, like I said, you know, there's so much talent coming. You know, you have Ben Rhodes now being in the Nation, or excuse me, Xfinity Series. Caught myself there. And they're adding more and more talent. And you already have Chase Elliott as well. So they have a bright future ahead of them for Hendrick Motorsports and even Stuart Haas Racing as well. You know, and we could see Cole Custer, who knows, maybe in a full-time truck or Xfinity ride come 2016.
Oh, I think it's very possible. And Tom, I'm looking at the pot on my desk right here, and there's been a dollar going into it every time I've caught somebody saying Nationwide still, since we're past January 1st. If I really had kept that up around my house, I'd be quickly becoming a very rich man.
Or a very broke man, if that's all you had left. But I and you'll notice that earlier I said Nationwide Now to be called Xfinity.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I just think that this is an interesting situation. As Kyle mentioned, you've got some K&N races in there, and I mean ARCA is always a possibility, but I never really thought about the idea that Junior Motorsports may be able to pick up some of the slack that or may be willing to pick up some of the slack that the Turner Scott breakup kind of left. And so again, when you think about an Austin Terrio, or you even think about Ben Rhodes, now that there's a truck program for Cole Custer, it may not happen this season, but certainly could be a possibility that perhaps Ben may run a few truck races at some point for them, in addition to his starts in the Xfinity series. So, you know, it just does open up a lot of interesting potential scenarios, and certainly another avenue for Junior Motorsports down the road to expand its base and its scope a little bit.
Oh, well, I think there's somebody potentially even more obvious than some of the guys you mentioned. And it happens to come in the form of a driver that we're going to have a little bit later on in the show that is another one of those who was kind of displaced by the Turner-Scott breakup of sorts. So I'm not convinced there might not be something there, too.
Well, that's another. And again, those
See?
Are all things. Yeah, those are all. That's why I said I think this move for Junior is interesting, because it opens up another whole potential for growth for that organization, more drivers to come in. And I really feel like this is going to be great for Cole Custer. I mean, what a – I know it was probably tough to be kind of left out in the whole Turner-Scott split, but certainly I think he wound up in a great situation. This is as good as he probably could have asked for, and I think Cole is championship material, to be honest with you, and certainly a driver that's capable of running up front and becoming a champion and going to the higher levels of the sport. So this is going to be a really interesting situation to see how this works out for him.
Yeah, it's going to be a very interesting situation indeed, Tom. And I'll transition from one interesting situation to another right here, because I'm glancing at some of the things that have been coming out of Wilmington, Delaware earlier today. And, you know, I moved from a great piece of news from Cole Custer to one that just has completely thrown me for a loop at this point, because I've sat here for the last hour and read some of the things going on as Kurt Busch's trial is kicking back up into swing, and everybody's trying to decide what's going on up there between he and Patricia Driscoll, and I'm just sitting here shaking my head going, okay, guys, there's some missing link here that everybody's either looking over, or there's something fishy going on, and I can't decide which one it is yet.
Well, you know, again, I have taken the position from the beginning with this piece, with this particular situation here, that I'm just not going to make judgments. I'm not going to even speculate, because when it comes to these types of situations, Jacob, and you and I have discussed this many times in the past, you have to be very wary of what you see and read and hear until all of the facts are out. And I'm really not, you know, this is one of those situations where I just think that if we're being responsible, we just need to hope that for the sake of the child that's involved, and, you know, for everyone's sake, really, that this turns out to be not what it could appear to be. I always, you know, these kind of TMZ things, I don't really like to get into a whole heck of a lot because it's a lot of he said, she said, they said, and it's unfortunate for Kurt Busch. If it's true, if the allegations are true, then obviously that's not going to be a nice situation. If the allegations aren't true, then it's unfortunate that he's being put in this situation. So, again, for me personally, I'm just simply not taking sides in this. Kurt appears to have, it has appeared that Kurt has been trying to grow out of, you know, and grow past or move past a lot of the, you know, things that he's been involved with and has tried over this past year to do things a little differently. So I'm just going to hope that, you know, this is not what it may appear.
And that's, I think, what a lot of people have thought from the beginning. So just one of those that, you know, we keep an eye on, but it's just hard to tell until things get over with. So there's that's in the news. And, you know, then we continue and look, and we've got things on the horizon. You and I were at Charlotte freezing our little selves this weekend to catch some racing. The Chili Bowl's coming up starting tomorrow night. And, hey, Sarah Fisher's driving in the Chili Bowl. I'm excited about that.
Well, I got to tell you, this the Chili Bowl, it's amazing how quickly we get back from a holiday break and we start talking about major race events. You got the Chili Bowl, and then a couple weeks from now, we're going to have the 24, and then it gets into February. Before you know it, we're talking about ARCA, then we're talking about, of course, the Sprint Unlimited, and we're talking about ARCA, we're talking about the truck race, the Xfinity race, Daytona 500. I mean, boy, it just all really starts and hits quick. But yeah, the Chili Bowl is always a blast. Alphabet soup, the ultimate definition of alphabet soup. I mean, I think the Chili Bowl and the IMCA Nationals about use up the alphabet when they start playing alphabet soup. And it's good to see Sarah Fisher coming out of retirement. I bet she has a lot of fun there. She hasn't raced in a few years, and this is kind of her background, so to speak. She was a microsport racer, I believe. So, you know, this is kind of her wheelhouse, and I don't think she'll feel a lot of pressure. I think she'll just go there, have a great time, and you know, it's got to be a blast for her to even be thinking about competing in an event like this, and a great change of pace too from all of the day-to-day IndyCar business she has to be involved in as a team owner.
Oh, sure. And it's one of those cases where she's got family. Kyle O'Gara, her brother-in-law, is also competing in the Chili Bowl, and that's actually how I got a chance to speak with her about some of what she's going to be doing tomorrow night on her qualifying night while I was at the Rumble in Fort Wayne. And she's just really excited about all this, excited about the IndyCar problem. But you're right, this is her background. That's where she started, Tom. So to be able to get back to that, and it's the first time she's been behind the wheel since she got out of the seat to start a family. So a little bit different. It's not an IndyCar, but it's fun to see her racing, and it's a little bit of star power for an event that's been dominated by the name Swindell for five of the last 6 years. So one of those things where you just say, hey, it's a new face, it's somebody different to talk about, and you know, she may not win it, but she can at least give it a heck of a shot.
No doubt.
So, with that being said, we've got a lot more to talk about. We're going to stay with the open wheel theme, but we're going to go mod squatting here in just a couple of minutes. We're going to hear from Spencer Davis, who I know is finishing his plans for the 2015 Wheel and Modified Tour, Wheel and Southern Modified Tour season, but he also picked up a fendered win, won the Zach Donati Memorial Pro Late Model race last weekend at New Smyrna Speedway. We'll hear from him on that and a whole lot more coming up in just a moment. You're listening to Motorsports Madness right here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at winyournewcar.com. That's right, winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming and start driving with winyournewcar.com.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right, it's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette, it's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes, on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit coopercorvettes.com.
Before a disaster turns your family's world upside down, it's up to you to be ready. Get a kit. Make a plan. Be informed. Learn how at www.ready.gov. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Ad Council.
On the air, you may know me as the man about motorsports. Actually, I've been the man about insurance for over 30 years. With one call, I can cover your life, health, auto, home, and business insurance. Recently, I saved a young couple over $500 on their annual car insurance bill. No gimmicks and no green lizard. So if you think your insurer is really your good neighbor who is on your side because he is holding your money in his good hands, think again. Call me, 703-631-8000. I have dozens of insurance companies waiting to give you the protection you need and deserve. It may take more than 15 minutes, but you'll receive sound advice, quality professional service, and an honest opinion. That number again, 703-631-8000. Ask for Larry O.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected.
Coming to Tampa Bay, I said we want to win a Super Bowl, and I believe we will.
From IamSecond.com.
We came close, but never really did win that championship.
Former NFL head coach Tony Dungy.
At the end of my 6th year, I was fired, and it was one of the biggest disappointments of my life. Next year, I'm in Indianapolis, get to the playoffs, but get knocked out again. And for the next couple of years, it's the same thing. Everyone is saying Colts are never going to win one. And I did wonder, why didn't it pan out the way I thought it would? But I determined that I had to have Christ first, and that everything else came below that, including my own desires. The next year, that ended up being our year to go to the Super Bowl and win it. And it was a wonderful feeling. Every decision I make, I'm going to make it through the lens of Jesus Christ. And he'd guide us to that ultimate victory.
Watch Tony's story at IamSecond.com.
You're listening to Speed 77 Radio on the Performance Motorsports Network. Now back to Jacob, Tom, and Kyle on Motorsports Madness.
Welcome back to the Madness here on Speed 77 Radio on the Performance Motorsports Network. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, sitting here at the round table. We sent Kyle Magda off to get some donuts, so he'll be back in just a little bit. But Tom, we get to talk a little bit of modified racing, a little bit of late model racing right now with a young driver who's been on the program with us a few times and just picked up a pretty big win last weekend at New Smyrna Speedway. Spencer, first off, want to welcome you to the program right here, and it's definitely one of those moments where you pick up a big win, and it kind of makes you look back a little bit on 2014 and get excited about 2015, because you win the Pro Late Model portion of Red Eye 100 weekend, and I know for you it's kind of a breakthrough because it's been a little bit since you got a win with Fenders. Talk about the race and how big a start this was to your 2015 season.
Well, first off, just thanks for, you know, having me on tonight, and it was real cool to win the first annual Zach Zanotti Memorial at New Smyrna. It was, you know, definitely cool to go into our first race of the year and get that first win. It's just, you know, kicking off 2015 right, and we ended 2014, you know, a little bit sour on not making the snowball and having some trouble in the snowflake, so I'm definitely glad to get that first win of the year.
It's the first win of the year, and I know that's always big to put on your plate. It's big for you because it kicks off your time in Florida in a pretty big way, because before too long, give it about another month, and you'll be back. I have to imagine with the modified, the pro late model, and the super late model for speed weeks and run about 25 or 30 races in a span of 8 or 9 days. So to kick off Florida with a big win like that, I'm sure has got to have your confidence pretty good going into speed weeks here next month.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Knowing that your stuff will run coming into 10 to 12 days of racing is definitely a good thing to know, because you know you're not going to go down there and struggle and you know, unless something happens, we'll be taking the same exact cars as we did, you know, we did last year that we ran at the, you know, Red Eye this past weekend. So it's definitely nice to know that, like I said, that you're going to have to be in good stuff that runs good there when you go back.
Well, talk a little bit about this first year in the modified. I know that that kind of came up late in the going last year, Spencer, and now this year you're going in with some time under your belt, and I'm sure a lot of confidence. What are your goals for this year? Are you guys actually talking championship, or what are your goals for the 2015 season?
You know, last year we won Rookie of the Year in the Midland Southern Modified Tour. So this year, it sounded like we're going to make our focus up north and go, you know, realistically go for the Northern Championship. We feel like we can do it. And, you know, Mr. David, the car owner and, you know, overall owner, he'll be the racing has the confidence in me, which, you know, is going to be a real good thing too. So, like I said, we're going to try to go up north and compete with the big guys.
Well, that's you got a lot of tracks up there. I remember a couple of years ago when Daniel Hemrick was doing some racing with the same team that you're with now, and I was talking to Daniel about the history of some of those tracks up there, and I know you got to play a little bit in the north last year as well. But what are you expecting in terms of are there tracks up there that you're going to that you haven't been to yet? What talk a little bit about what your anticipation is for up there.
You know, I've never been to any of the tracks up there besides Thompson and Waterford that, you know, they run on for the tour. So it's definitely going to be a little bit challenging even seeing, you know, to seeing those tracks for the first time when we get there. But,
yeah,
you know, the whole Hillbilly 79 group, is, you know, ran the tour for so long and had been to those tracks a lot, so that's going to help a lot because they kind of know what the driver needs to do, and they already have the sit-up, you know, down pat for those tracks. So just going in there with a well-produced team that's been racing those tracks for years and years is, you know, definitely going to help.
Well, now, up there, of course, a whole different set of circumstances and situations to deal with, and a level of competition that is extremely high. Not that it isn't here in the South, but boy, just a tremendous amount of competition in the North Country. And that's got to be a neat feeling for you to be expanding your horizons a little bit. What made you guys decide to try to go up and run for the North Championship instead of running for the Southern Championship down here?
You know, like you said, the competition is definitely up north. First or 20th can, you know, win the race easily at any time. And, you know, that's where modifieds are from, you know, from up north. And that's where all the legends are, you know, like Teddy Christopher and everyone like that. So going up north, you know, is definitely like saying you're ready to compete with the big dogs in modified racing. Plus all the tracks you go to this year, you know, they got almost all the same tracks as last year, but, you know, running more races at Thompson this year and tracks like that, you know, it's definitely going to be a real cool thing to do.
It's going to be cool, I know, on your end, Spencer. And it's one of those things where you've put yourself with a team that knows how to win races and how to go for a championship. And I know the bar just keeps creeping up for you. Did you expect to be at the stage right now that you're at where you guys feel like you're ready to contend for this championship, just the second year of you being with the Hillbilly team? I mean, I know you shocked me last year when you did what you did in the modified, and I'm just curious where you guys think, because I know I feel like you guys overachieved last year.
You know, we definitely met our goals last year that we set at the beginning of the year. The main one was to, you know, win Rookie of the Year, which we achieved that. But, you know, our goal was to run top 10 consistent every weekend. And, you know, a top 5 would be definitely real good. But like you said, I think we exceeded that too, because we were competing for wins and led tons of laps and, you know, even got some poles this year. So I say we definitely exceeded our expectations, you know, for last year.
I want to go back to the prolate model for just a second, because obviously we were talking about the win in the Donati Memorial, and I know how tough a track New Smyrna is, and it was just a 50-lap race, so it really is one of those short sprints almost, not like the modified races you've been running. Was it tougher on you at all, knowing that there wasn't a lot of time to get the job done in that race last weekend, or did it actually make it a little easier on you since you had run so many longer distance races last year?
You know, that's definitely kind of 50-50. You know, we set the pole, so that was real good because we knew we had the speed to get back up there. When we did the redraw, we redrew, you know, we had to redraw the top three, so that set us back just a little bit, but in those short distance races, you know, you can't hold back at all. You got to go all out from the beginning. You know, after running ski weeks and a bunch of short races and late models, you know, we know how to get it done. But it was also nice at the same time to know that you'll be going all out and you don't have, you know, as many laps for something to happen. All, you know, just, you know, a freak accident, you know, a tire blowing or getting tangled up in a wreck with someone else, or, you know, just, I guess, misguiding it wrong with a lap call or something like that. So, like I said, it's 50-50, but it was nice to run a short race for once.
Well, we thought you might have had a chance at the super late model portion of the race as well, but just came up a little bit short there.
Oh, yeah. You know, we came up all the way up to third almost in the 100 after right there. And we had a parts malfunction that regulated us, you know, made our car real tight, but, you know, we still rebounded and had a fifth place finish, and you know, I definitely couldn't thank all the guys enough for making it happen in the pit.
You've really done an excellent job in the late model, and I know you're enjoying running the modified as well. How much can we expect to see you in the late model car in 2015? I know the modified, it appears, is going to be your first priority again, but are we going to see you any more in the late model than we did this year? Because I know you cut way back on that schedule for this past season.
Oh, yeah, we plan on running all the Pensacola races of the Southern Super Series, as well as some select pass races, just to keep our feet wet, keep on top of the game, so to say, in the late model series. So we're looking forward to that, and, you know, glad Tom Mayberry's having another season, and, you know, for his pass south, and also thankful for the Southern Super Series, you know, running down south at all the tracks that all the prime late model competition is at.
It's definitely been prime, and you've made yourself one of those prime contenders, Spencer, and always look forward to seeing you down here running some of those races. And I know the success you've had recently can't be possible by yourself, and want to give you a chance to say thank you to some of the people, sponsors, supporters that helped make it happen.
Oh, yeah, I'd like to thank, you know, first off, Coors Light 21 means 21. We couldn't do it in the late model and the modified portion without those guys, as well as Green Heating and Air, Rude Heating and Air. You know, those guys have been with us since the beginning, along with, you know, Overnight Wraps, the Georgia Racing Hall of Fame, you know, Speed 51, Park City Auto Parts, Core Race Products, and Davis Poultry Equipment.
It's been fun to watch so far, Spencer, and looking forward to seeing what you can do in Speed Weeks, not even thinking about the fact that not long after that, the Southern Tour season gets ready to kick off. So, again, appreciate you taking a few minutes to come on and talk with us, and wish you the best of luck headed into the next couple of months, because I know, if nothing else, you're going to make it a whole lot of fun to watch you along the way.
Oh, yeah, that's for sure, bud. And, you know, I'd like to thank you and Mr. Tom for having me on.
We appreciate it. That's Spencer Davis, and in just a couple minutes now, we are going to shift gears but stay in the NASCAR Short Track family. Coming up, Cameron Haley joins us on the line to talk about what he's got going for 2015. That's next after these words. You are listening to Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
In the Pits Media is proud to present its newest partner, WinYourNewCar.com. That's right, you now can enter the number one American Dream Car Contest giveaway at WinYourNewCar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming, start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
Car problems? You can trust your local Cottman man. Cobman has a 40-year history as a leader in car repair and making happy, satisfied customers. Whatever's wrong with your car, SUV, or truck, Cobman will check it out free using state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment. Don't take chances with your car. Bring it to Cobman and let your local Cobman man show you why they are America's transmission and total auto care experts. Visit Cobman.com to download money-saving coupons. Cobman. Real service, real fast.
You know that phone call is going to come at the worst possible time. Right at the end of the game. Fourth quarter, fourth down, and 1 yard to go. They're piling up, but you can't watch that. You got to get that car off the road. This could have been prevented if you have taken advantage of Cotman's free TransCheck 21. Here's a chance to have us look at your car and head off any problems that could happen that could interrupt that game. Again, it's a free check. Come see us.
See Leonard and the fine folks at Cotman of Manassas, 9113 Mathis Avenue in Manassas. Give them a call at 703-365-7200.
Before a disaster turns your family's world upside down, it's up to you to be ready. Get a kit. Make a plan. Be informed. Learn how at www.ready.gov. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Ad Council.
If you're a gearhead, you probably go online to those hot rod superstores, drooling over the chrome and speed goodies until you find just the right item for your muscle car, tuner car, truck. But what do you do when it comes to fixing the mom mobile? If you're like most do-it-yourselfers, you head to the strip mall parts store and talk to the "Do you want fries with that?" kid behind the counter. Hold on, Bunky. Did you stop to think where those chain stores are getting the parts that you're installing in the vehicle that's used to transport your family everywhere? They get the cheapest suppliers they can find to sell you the parts at bargain prices. Their limited lifetime warranties? What a joke. Remember the last time mom's car broke down? You heard about that one for weeks. Don't take that chance again. Excelsior Racing has the quality parts you need for your family vehicle. Parts that you can install knowing you're getting the best for your family. Excelsior Racing. Quality parts. Personalized service. Affordable pricing. Fast to you direct. Excelsior Racing. Online at ExcelsiorRacing.com or call 502-909-2034.
Hi, everybody. This is Geddy Lee for RAD. To many of us, drunk driving is something that other people do. Certainly not one of our friends or relatives would do such a thing. When you see someone who's had too much to drink, about to get into a car, urge them to give up the keys and find alternate transportation. Always choose a designated driver. Remember, music lives, you should too.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
Let's throw the green for Open Wheel Central on Motorsports Madness. Back to Jacob, the crew, and the only racing insider to ever use Snuggies for Dogs in a conversation about IndyCar, Joel Sebastianelli.
And Snuggies for Dogs will never get old. We're just going to keep throwing that in Joel's face until the end of time or madness, whichever comes first. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda around the round table and continuing our jaunt through the NASCAR short tracks with Open Wheel coming up here in just a few minutes. But right now, getting ready to talk. I'm not really sure what, Tom, because we've not heard a whole lot out of our next guest so far, but Cameron Haley's been on with us a few times, and, nice to bring the Maple Leafs back onto the program, and I'm ready to find out what he's doing.
I am, too. Let's get him out here and talk to him. Cameron Haley, welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Good to have you back on the program.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you guys very much for having me back on.
We're excited to do that, and really, first of all, just want to give you an opportunity to talk a little bit about the season past, 2014. Not a bad year for you, and definitely had to be a big learning year for you.
Oh, for sure. That was learning was probably the key word this year. I mean, obviously, I'm a young driver trying to grow up and make this my career. And every year I'm going to learn that little bit, but it seemed this year, more than any year, really seemed like I learned a lot. I mean, we did have a great year. We had our ups and downs, just like everyone would in a season, but to finish up in the Can-Am East Series second, I think is a really good accomplishment. And not only that, but the three truck starts I made all went really well. And to get that experience, or get my feet wet, I guess, in the mile and a half in a truck was probably the most I've learned in a race ever in my career. So it was good to get my feet wet. We had a good season and just hope to carry that on this year.
I know you're hoping to carry that on this year. And before I ask you about this year, I'm curious because you finished second in the standings in K&N East to your teammate Ben Rhodes, and you had statistically on paper it was a good year. You had 7 top fives, 9 top tens, and the only thing that stuck out was not getting to victory lane. Was that one of those things that you look back on it now? Has that been tough on you at all going into this off season? It you came so close so many different times and just could never get that one break to fall quite your way.
Yeah, I mean that is always a tough thing. And I think you mentioned 7 top fives, and I think out of those 7 top fives, 6 of them were second place. So that's a tough one to swallow, really, when you get down to it at the end of the year. But, I mean, the part that kind of helps looking back on it is I know we were there, and it was just little things like flat tires, just being in the wrong place at the wrong time, being on the outside of on a restart that only allows the inside line to go. And there's just a whole bunch of little factors all year that just kind of it seemed to hinder us from getting that win. And it was frustrating. I'm not going to lie. It was all year. But I know I'm capable of winning. I know our team was capable of winning. And, I mean, part of this racing thing is a little bit of luck. And we just didn't quite have that luck this year.
I know that's the one thing that really eluded you, but I know you're the kind of guy that just looks at it, puts it out of his mind, and moves on to the next thing. So that's kind of what we'll do right here, and it kind of brings me to really the million-dollar question where you're concerned. Do we know what you're doing for next year? Do you know what you're doing, or I guess this year now, do you know what you're doing for this year just yet?
You know, to tell you the truth, I really wish I did. We definitely have some really good opportunities going at this point, and I'm very confident that it's going to be the direction I want to head in. But currently, right now, we can't really release anything and don't really have anything set in stone. But I can tell you that it's going to be some good opportunities here, and hopefully further that learning even more.
I like hearing the words in the works. That at least means that there's progress. I mean, if you painted the picture your way for 2015, where do you ultimately want to end up with this? I mean, do we see you more on the national scene, maybe a truck ride or something? Is that kind of what you guys are working towards?
Yeah, for sure. Definitely. Ever since planning for 2015 started last year, we really wanted to focus on that truck ride. I think I've been in K&N now between the West Series and East Series. I've been in it for 3 years, and it was definitely time for a change. But also with wanting that change comes an increase in the money that goes along with it, which is always a problem. But if I had it my way, I would definitely want to run a full truck season. It's just finding that funding to be able to do that.
Cameron, what were some of the things you learned during the 2014 K&N East season? I know you didn't get the win that you wanted, but what were some of the things you took out running for Turner Scott Motorsports?
Well, you know, it was such a great opportunity to be able to run for Turner Scott Motorsports, and they gave me great cars all year. And the biggest thing for me, obviously, our luck wasn't on our side, and we didn't have the runs every time out that we wanted to, but I think the biggest thing for me, not so much even on a driving standpoint, but just, it's something that people don't really think about, but the emotional side that goes along with driving cars. And it may seem like just driving in circles, but when you're out there, the emotions that you have to channel when you're mad, when you're unhappy with something, when things go good, not to get too high on yourself. And there's just a whole bunch of emotions that I really learned this year to kind of channel and turn that into something positive.
Yeah, and of course you have the 4 other teammates. You have Kaz Grawl, Brandon Jones, Scott Heckren, and Ben Rhodes. Out of the 4, which one gave you the most advice to hopefully expand your learning curve?
Well, you know, it seemed like Ben and I were definitely the ones that were kind of racing around each other all year. And like I said, every time you're out on that racetrack, you're learning something. And there's just little things that I think Ben picked up from me. Me being behind Ben a couple of times, I picked up from him. And there's just little things you can go back and forth. But, I mean, between all those four drivers, we all kind of bounced things off of each other and went back and forth. And it's just great to be part of an organization that can have that many drivers and that many drivers close enough to your age that you can really relate to and talk to things about.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask you about, Cameron, because, you know, sometimes you can get a group of drivers and you get, you know, one or two that, how do I put this nicely, aren't necessarily great teammates, but you guys all really seemed like you genuinely had a great friendship and relationship with each other, and it showed on the racetrack. It looked like you guys just had a lot of fun working together and enjoyed being around each other. That's that had to have been a very enjoyable experience for you.
Yeah, for sure it was, and it was something new to me. Back in the West Series, I had both teams I was with, Bill McAnally and Gene Price Motorsports, both had veteran drivers that I was teammates with, and that was good in some respects to get that veteran support and veteran advice. But then coming to Turner Scott Motorsports and not having that veteran anymore and kind of just having more equal peers to talk to was definitely a different thing for me, but I think it helped in a different way than a veteran could. And I think that helped me along with all the other four drivers in order for us all to get better.
I know that's a big help. And actually, I've got a really interesting question for you, Cameron, because you mentioned one of those former teams that that you drove for, Gene Price Motorsports, and you were a big part of the growth that team had and a lot of success with them over their existence and the time that you drove for them. Is it a situation for you with seeing that team kind of quietly go into the night after winning the championship out west again this year? Is that one of those things that you can look back and be proud of the time you spent there to have helped build that team into what it was at the end?
Oh, for sure. I mean, Gene Price is such an awesome guy, and he's going to be a guy that I have a relationship for the rest of my life. And he was a guy who gave me a great opportunity, always gave me great cars, and to work with a veteran driver like Greg Pursley was a huge experience and something that taught me a lot. And like you said, just to be part of the success of that team, I mean, three championships, I don't even know how many wins, how many poles, but just to be part of that statistic is pretty cool to be able to, I mean, obviously it's bittersweet to see them not come back for a full season again this year, but just to be part of it was an awesome opportunity.
And I know you've got a lot of awesome opportunities ahead that you guys are trying to put together. And I know it's not possible without a lot of people and supporters behind you, Cameron. And want to give you a chance to shout out to some of the people and sponsors behind you that have made the deal happen so far. So who makes it happen for Cameron Haley?
Well, I mean, my dad's company, Cabinets by Haley. My entire family has been behind me since day one. And they're really the ones that make it happen, and Cabinets by Haley being a huge part of that. And I also have to give a shout-out to Curb Records. They helped us out a lot this year, and it just allows me to further my career, get more truck races, and, I mean, every little bit helps. So just thanks to all those people.
I mean, you've got to be fired up. You just watched your teammate who won the championship end up with Junior Motorsports. I'm sure if you could get something that was half as good as the deal that that Ben found himself, you'd be a happy camper for this year.
Yeah, for sure. It's definitely some big things to come here, and I'll keep everybody posted and hopefully be back on here soon with some really good news.
Well, we will be glad to have you back on here as soon as you've got something to announce, Cameron. So we appreciate the time and looking forward to when the time comes and you get ready to go racing.
Yeah, for sure. Me too.
That's Cameron Haley, and we certainly wish him well as he continues his search for a ride and a seat for 2015. And with that, we will take a few minutes here and do some business. And coming up next, we'll pull out the wine and the cheese and the crackers and get ready to feed Joel, because Open Wheel Central is coming up in just a few moments. And boy, if there's ever drama, this is a segment you won't want to miss. So stay with us. Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at winyournewcar.com. That's right, winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free, delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming and start driving with winyournewcar.com.
Before a disaster turns your family's world upside down, it's up to you to be ready. Get a kit. Make a plan. Be informed. Learn how at www.ready.gov. Brought to you by the Federal Emergency Management Agency and the Ad Council.
Motorsports sales professionals. Scorpion Radio Group Incorporated's Performance Motorsports Network is looking to build a team of experienced media sales professionals to represent our motorsports programming to the industry's top companies, magazines, and racing series. If you have motorsports sales or marketing experience, know how to work with agencies, understand social media, and are incredibly creative when it comes to working with clients and promotions, then we want to hear from you. Top performers are richly rewarded. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444 or email Sue at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. That's 717-749-0444 or email Sue at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com.
Here's an important message from Rad and this station.
Hi, I'm Melissa Etheridge for Rad, recording artist against drunk driving. Your lifestyle is your business, but when you drive drunk, you become everyone's business. Don't drink and drive. Be responsible. Choose a designated driver. Music lives, and so should you. Please, don't drink and drive.
Hi, this is Yen Scott from Summit Point Kart in Summit Point, West Virginia. If you're looking for a real racing experience on a real racetrack, come out to Summit Point Kart this weekend. For as little as $25, you can get your racing career started. New this year, Summit Point Kart offers the RX250 capable of over 75 miles an hour. We're open every Friday from 5 p.m. till 9 p.m., Saturday from noon till 10 p.m., and Sunday from noon till 9 p.m. For more information, go to our website, summitpointkartwithak.com, or you can call us at 304-725-5270. Summit Point Kart, your East Coast karting center.
For 17 years, Stock Car Steel has been a leading material supplier to the racing industry. Now they're also an official motorsports content partner of Race Chaser Online. The biggest names in NASCAR trust Stock Car Steel for all their raw materials, such as carbon steel, chrome moly, DOM, aluminum, plastics, and much, much more. You can't build a race car without the basic materials, and Stock Car Steel is the place to get them. Don't forget to also visit Stock Car Steel's sister company, SRI Supplies, for racing and industry. SRI is your number one source for all your shop supply needs. Nuts, bolts, rivets, tapes, adhesives, cutting tools, chemicals, body shop supplies, paint shop supplies, lubricants, and more. A well-stocked race shop is a winning race shop, and the road to winning begins with three letters, SRI. For more information, visit StockCarSteel.com and SRI-Supplies.com. You can also find them on Facebook at Stock Car Steel and Aluminum, or call either company toll-free at 1-888-752-7272.
Let's throw the green for Open Wheel Central on Motorsports Madness. Back to Jacob, the crew, and the only racing insider to ever use Snuggies for Dogs in a conversation about IndyCar, Joel Sebastianelli.
Welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda here at the roundtable with the aforementioned wine and cheese lover himself, Joel Sebastianelli. And Joel, before we get into all the fun stuff, I'll get into something that ties into all the fun stuff, and the fact that you had a pretty busy weekend working with the Road to Indy TV crew and getting your feet wet with all that, and I'm sure probably getting a few tidbits from around the whole IndyCar world as well.
What do you mean before all the fun stuff? This is the fun stuff. And
I didn't actually have to wait until March to go out racing. Their headquarters at Anderson Race Park, went out there and did a little bit of karting myself. Got whooped, which is absolutely no surprise, but really excited. A lot of great things in store, I think, with Mazda Road to Indy TV. It's a fantastic opportunity, and I'm really, really excited for it to work with JP Manarola and everybody on that team, all of the drivers in Indy Lights, Pro Mazda, and USF 2000. It's going to be really exciting. We shot a few promos in Palmetto, Florida on Friday. I'll be going back to St. Pete. We're going to do get working on that first episode this coming weekend. So a lot of great things in store, and can't wait for testing to finally get underway, get out there, and, of course, for the season to start as well in March.
I know you're just waiting for March to get here so we can actually go racing, Joel. But we still
got
a little bit of time. Yeah, impatiently more like. Hey, I'll throw you a bone. Schmidt Peterson and Jack Harvey are back together for 2015. I know that's right in your wheelhouse now. And I'll tell you what, to lose the championship on the second tiebreaker last year, if that's not a driver and team combination that's a bit fired up to go racing, I don't know what is.
Oh, yeah. You know, Indy Lights has so many talented guys, a lot of talented guys on those feeder series, and just 21 years old, has a little bit of unfinished business. Tied with Gabby Chavez with 547 points last season, actually won four of the last five races. Him and Gabby both finished with the same number of wins, and so it actually went to the second tiebreaker there. And Gabby ended up taking home the title and the scholarship that goes with it if he can find an IndyCar ride. So for Jack Harvey, obviously this is the logical place to go. Sign again with Schmidt Peterson Motorsports. It was a great partnership last year. And I think with a lot of bigger names, you know, Gabby Chavez, for example, Sage Karam, Zach Veach, maybe if it's only even part-time with Andretti Autosport, I think there are a lot of names moving up and going elsewhere. So in Indy Lights, it's a revitalized division. A lot of newer drivers coming in, some new faces, some very experienced faces too. But as a returning guy and somebody who accomplished so much with SPM and Indy Lights in 2014, I would expect bigger and better, even though there's not much room for improvement come 2015 from Harvey and that team.
There's not much room for improvement, and I think that's what makes it so difficult. When you look at that operation, really, it's anything but a championship is not enough for them next year. They set the bar so high in year one, so you've got that to look forward to. You've got the potential of almost 20-car grids for Indy Lights, which I'm sure you're psyched about, Joel, and it's just a whole world of change around there. And talk about change. I've heard rumors that aero kits may not be progressing quite as quickly as some of us, mainly me and you, might have hoped.
Well, I hear all sorts of different things. I think that's just the nature of off-season. You know, we spend more time bench racing, obviously, in the winter and thinking of all these different scenarios than we do actually on the tracks. So I've got absolutely nothing concrete that I've heard about that. And in fact, at this point, we're January 18th, I believe, is actually when most of this manufacturer testing is going to end. That's the date set for homologation. So at that point, production will ramp up, and there's supposed to be a March 1st deadline with aero kit scheduled to debut for the first race of this, second race of the season, rather, in St. Petersburg. Will it happen? We'll see. I've heard nothing concrete to support things either way, but everything I've seen, every indication from the series at least, and it's understand why they would want to keep that under wraps if it was actually an issue, but every indication from the series will be that once the season starts, the aero kits are going to be there too. And if we hear anything else about that, obviously, I think we can rush to judgment a little bit later then.
I'll tell you, Joel, I don't know that I would have thought that if someone had said to me, there are going to be nearly 20 Indy Lights cars this year. I don't know if I would have thought they were running a low-grade fever or what the situation is, but can you believe, really, that we're where we are? Because I got to tell you and I have talked about this for a year or two, as is Jacob as well, the fact that we just think this series has such tremendous potential, but there was just no car count. Now, all of a sudden, they go to a new chassis, and it's just like they're coming out of the woodwork now. So, I mean, this is just gearing up to be a fantastic season of Indy Lights with some tremendous competition.
I completely agree. It's a revolutionary sort of time for Indy Lights. This is the beginning of a new era for this series, and Dan Anderson deserves so much credit. I mean, imagine just a couple years ago, right? Anderson, he's not a big gambler, not somebody who necessarily wants to take big risks like that, and this was a big investment for him.
Yeah.
But can you imagine that there were several groups of people, including car owners, who thought that, no, we need to stick with this car. You know, we need to cut costs in every way possible. I mean, think about it. If they had their way, we would still be using the same car in 2020. I mean, it would become so obsolete that it would kill Indy Lights. And so, look, it's not the most inexpensive car, the Dallara IL-15, but it's a sleek, sexy piece of machinery, and it's getting people excited about it. It's at least a reasonable cost. It gives this series so much credibility to have European teams like Carlin coming over. I think that with the car count the way it is right now, not just the car count, but the talent level, Indy Lights is going to be a series to watch in 2015, and it is clearly growing. This isn't just a one-year spurt. This is going to be a continuous growth, and I am so excited, especially with the international aspect now, with Carlin coming in. You can bet teams like, and you know, I'm just throwing out random team names here, but you know, that could be interested, but somebody like Garden International, and you know, all these teams, GP2, GP3, with that sort of experience, you can bet that if the racing is good here and Carlin performs well, they're going to take note. And this is going to be a really, really big deal, not just for Indy Lights, but for IndyCar.
Oh, it's going to be a really big deal, and I'm looking forward to it. And with looking forward to it, I'm unshockingly, Joel, going to shift gears now for a second, because there's I'll throw you three bullet points in quick succession right here. Let's go F1 for a minute. Korea's gone, Qatar may be existing, and Honda's screaming about engines.
Okay, Korea gone, not really a big surprise. I was surprised it even joined the provisional calendar to begin with, which is unfortunate because I really do like that track itself, even though in some sections it still looks like it's an unfinished racetrack. But I really did like the Yongam circuit, but not really surprised it's gone. As for Qatar, that's a very ambitious goal to do that, and it won't be used on the MotoGP circuit either. They want to build a brand new street circuit that could actually happen as early as 2016, although I doubt that every step of the way. I think that's even more ambitious, but they want to hold it in the new city of Lusail, which is actually going to be a big site for the World Cup. So for Qatar, it's a big deal as a country, but if Bahrain were to veto this, it'll be interesting to see what they do, because I don't really know if the Middle East is ready for a second Formula One race yet, especially one that's in such close proximity to Bahrain. So I think that this is not just a little overambitious on Qatar's part, but it is on Formula One's part. And I think that even if this race does happen, it's going to be a few more years down the road. It's certainly not going to be next year. And you know, you gave me quick points in succession. You know, I can't be quick though. What was the third one?
Let's see. Honda and engine development or the lack thereof.
Honda, that's right. Yeah, the FIA is actually going to meet with Honda relatively soon over the 2015 engine development rules. And we've heard so much about engines and the power units in the off season. This is kind of strange. Honda is very upset that the FIA has essentially given the okay to Mercedes, Ferrari, Renault. They've given them the okay to develop their power units over the course of 2015 instead of just hitting the preseason deadline. And of course, there was the loophole in the rule that Ferrari discovered, and I think at this point we're familiar with that. But the FIA says that Honda will have to submit their power unit, and it's going to have to remain at the same specification handed into the FIA on February 28th. Because as a new manufacturer, they say that Honda has benefited from being able to develop its new V6 engine without any sort of restriction until the end of next month. So I certainly can't blame Honda for being wrong. I think in some ways it's a little bit ridiculous, but from the rival's side, I do see why they would be upset. So the FIA never wants to shy away from drama, right? Just seems to find them.
Yes, it does seem to find them, and when it finds them, we find it. Joel, hang with us here for just a second. More Open Wheel Central coming up on the other side. First, this business. You're listening to Motorsports Madness, and it's mad right here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
Hi, this is Yen Scott from Summit Point Kart in Summit Point, West Virginia. If you're looking for a real racing experience on a real racetrack, come out to Summit Point Kart this weekend. For as little as $25, you can get your racing career started. New this year, Summit Point Kart offers the RX250, capable of over 75 miles an hour. We're open every Friday from 5 p.m. till 9 p.m., Saturday from noon till 10 p.m., and Sunday from noon till 9 p.m. For more information, go to our website, summitpointkartwithak.com, or you can call us at 304-725-5270. Summit Point Kart, your East Coast karting center.
In the race of everyday life, it's nice to have the green flag, but drivetrain problems are the pits. A fully remanufactured engine, transmission, or differential from Jasper Engines and Transmissions costs less than a new vehicle and comes with a 3-year, 100,000-mile nationwide transferable warranty. See jasperengines.com for details and get the green flag in your race of everyday life.
See the boys at Chandler & Sons Automotive, 45977 Old Ox Road in Sterling. Give them a call, 703-437-7300.
Ever hire, never quit. Lofty goals in this age of shoddy quality, corporate indifference, and built-in obsolescence. It's a beacon of light in a crowded field of mediocrity. The way a company is run is an indication of how you, the customer, is going to be treated. You have a lot of choices when you're searching for auto and performance parts online and at the corner parts store. So why should you buy from Excelsior Racing? Because they're simply the best online parts supplier in the business. If you're looking for selection, ease of ordering, cost, and prompt delivery, look no further. If you have a question, our customer service hotline, staffed by knowledgeable gearheads like you, will ensure that you get what you need to fix or mod your car or truck. With 1,000 suppliers, you're guaranteed to get what you need. First time, every time. Excelsior Racing. Excellence on the track. Excellence on the road. Excellence in customer service. Online at ExcelsiorRacing.com or call 502-909-2034.
All I wanted to do was just pick up a guitar and sing praise songs.
From IamSecond.com.
Well, when I got to 17, I was playing in after-hours bars, just in a bunch of trouble.
Grammy Award winner Michael W. Smith.
Smoking that first joint and feeling so guilty about it. From there, it was LSD, and your compass sort of just like disappeared. I knew where I belonged. I just couldn't get out. I was very depressed. I went on the floor and just began to shake. And I was just weeping. I was weeping. And I just began to just cry out for God. 12:30 at night, on the linoleum floor of my kitchen, the God of the universe came and wept with me on that floor. I know where my hope lies. It's not being a rock star. I'm a son of the High King of the universe.
Watch Michael's story at IamSecond.com.
Time to get back to tonight's Motorsports Madness. Here are the only three of a kind that beat the full house. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, and Kyle Magda.
We're three of a kind, but we're hiding Magda in the corner right now because, you know, it's open wheel and we like Joel just a little bit better. Sorry, Kyle. Yeah, you break the universe too, but we won't talk about that. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. Jacob Seelman, Kyle Magda, Tom Baker, Open Wheel Central continuing with Joel Sebastianelli. And Joel, we were talking Formula One before the break. I'll continue on that for a minute because another thing that came across my desk this morning that I was a little bit intrigued by, or not surprised, just intrigued, is the fact that according to several reports, Mercedes and the Silver Arrows are set to offer Lewis Hamilton a new 3-year contract extension after the end of this season. And I, you know, it's the best pairing in the sport right now. Why break up a good thing, right?
Exactly. It really makes sense to leave him on. It would be a big deal, too. £25 million, which is actually somewhere in the neighborhood of $37 million in change, that deal for Lewis Hamilton. So, hey, you're a double world champion making that kind of pay. He's living the life, right? Obviously, such a great season with Mercedes, and that is owed just as much to the success of the team. And happy birthday, Toto Wolff, by the way. You know, for those guys, it's a you have to do this. I think I was one of the doubters in his camp pre-2014 because he's somebody who's shown at times to get caught up in the heat of the moment, not always be the best on the track in terms of dealing with the team off the track as well. But when you look at everything he did in 2014 on and off the track, he settled all those doubts. And truth be told, whether it was Monza or Belgium, anytime there was somebody caught up in the heat of the moment, somebody making mistakes, it wasn't Lewis Hamilton, it was Nico Rosberg. And that's not to say anything negative about Rosberg at all, but I think at this point Hamilton has to have silenced every critic, and they ought to lock him up for as many years as they can get, because you're absolutely right, it's the best pairing in the sport right now.
It's the best pairing in the sport, and it's poised to continue, I think, in 2015, despite the fact that apparently Red Bull and Daniel Ricciardo thinks they may have found something. I can't believe that unless the annual Jerez test just completely shocks somebody. But yeah, what are the odds of that? If Mercedes found the horsepower that we were talking about last week that they found, I don't see any way anybody catches up to him. And I think it's the Rosberg and Hamilton show again, regardless of the fact that Ricciardo won three races last year.
And I think you're right, but until they actually get on the track and start testing in Spain, it's very difficult to tell. Of course, these teams know what they've got, and I think to some extent you have to play that PR game. Whether it's true or not, the information that's out there is out there for a reason. Anytime a driver or a team releases any sort of statement like that, official or otherwise, it's not something that's just a slip of the tongue. You know, there's a reason it went out there. So I think when those reports came out a couple weeks ago about Mercedes finding that extra horsepower, as we said then, everybody else was behind the eight ball to begin with heading into 2015. Now they're either further back down the table. So these teams knew that they had to put up or shut up at this point. And I know Red Bull has absolutely been working furiously to have the success they had had for four straight years and then have Sebastian Vettel held completely off the board with race victories in 2014. And Daniel Ricciardo being the only other bright spot on that team, consistently finishing up front near the podium and on the top step of the podium a few times. They're very eager to get back to where they were just 2 years ago. So will they get there in one season? No, certainly not to that level of dominance. Could they get up there, win a few races, and maybe even contend for a title? I think it's unlikely. I think Mercedes is still the top dog, but who's to say that Red Bull Racing hasn't found something? Again, until we actually see these cars revealed at the end of January and we get them on the track twice at Barcelona and once at Jerez, I think that it's very difficult to say anything that's just pure speculation at this point.
And we know how you are with speculation, so we'll just put that to rest and move on. And I'll throw you something that's far from speculation. It's fact, and it's fiery, just like you. Mario Andretti made a few comments that you would be quite proud of, I think, earlier today, and everybody's been screaming about it since it came out last week. But Frank Montani in the Formula E class. He just kind of disappeared off the map recently, and nobody could figure out why until last week when a drug test comes back positive for a cocaine derivative. And Mario Andretti comes out earlier today and says, well, if that's the case, he needs to be banned for life.
Totally disagree. Actually, a little bit disappointed in those comments. And on the one hand, this is something that for the entire Andretti family and for that team with his involvement in Formula E, I would be very upset too. But, you know, first of all, what you do on your own time, I really don't care what you do. Don't put it anywhere near the racetrack. It's a dangerous enough sport as it is. And I have no idea at what point he would have tested positive, whether it had something to do with being on the racetrack or not. So to me, if that's part of the issue and you can actually pinpoint it to that time frame, then sure. But this is about a person. This isn't just about a business. He deserves a very significant punishment, but a lifetime ban is very, very harsh. Look, there's no room in motorsport for any sort of involvement with drugs anywhere near the track at all. But this needs to be treated as a health issue and as a personal issue. You know, drivers have done all sorts of terrible things, all right? I am not condoning it at all, but we all make bad choices, and especially if this is something that, as some reports have speculated, that dates back to his Formula One days, then the first priority here should be getting him the help that he needs. It's about saving the person, not punishing them and destroying them. And if he's going to go to rehab, undergo testing, and he can be clean at that point going forward, what's the problem? Because I'm sure it'll be difficult enough to find a ride in the first place if you want to talk about karma and everything else. You know, he may never get a chance to go back on the track again. But how many of the people condemning him can say that they've never made a terrible mistake at some point in their life that they were called out for or that flew completely under the radar? Not condoning it at all, but a lifetime ban is very, very harsh. Although I don't know the full extent of the circumstances. Also worth noting, it's a cocaine derivative. Did not necessarily test positive for cocaine. So there are other ways besides just simply cocaine, other sort of drug involvement that it could be. So you have to make sure that we're clear that it was a cocaine derivative, not necessarily cocaine. So that's my two cents. I really think that this is a personal issue and it should be treated as a health issue. It should be all about rehab, not simply destroying him, because quite frankly, that does no good for anybody whatsoever.
I couldn't agree with you more, Joel, and I can't say it any better than that. I was going to say actually almost all the things you said, because I think that for Mario to come out and just make a blanket statement like that, first of all, he's certainly entitled to his opinion, but second of all, I think you have to assign the appropriate amount of bias and anger and frustration, as you pointed out, over the fact that he was a part of that team in Formula E. I don't think that this is a situation where we should be banning somebody for life. I think, as you said, you should have in place a testing, a rehabilitation procedure, and I think also the fact that when this all first came out, his own statements about it, I really feel like he understood the gravity of the situation, and he seemed very, very concerned about his future and almost understanding of what the worst could possibly be. So I agree with you, Joel. I think that was very well said. I think a significant amount of time away from the sport, I think he should be made to go and get the proper treatment, and it needs to be proven that he is completely, you know, clean and removed from all of that. And then if he could get a second chance, Jacob, I'll let you jump in here. I don't see why he shouldn't be given a second chance, to be honest.
I don't see why he shouldn't either, but I'm more interested in somebody that can go find me a thermometer, put it to the ground, and check the temperature, because you and Joel agreeing on anything on this show is scary.
It happens once every 76 years, so Haley's comet is close.
Better than 86 years, that's for sure. That number rings a little bit sore to me.
On that note.
That number's climbing again, too.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna cut.
Can
into
you
this
save
part.
Us here, Jacob?
Yeah,
save us. Thank you.
Yeah, I need to find some way to, because y'all two are already beyond help. But no, Joel, I'm really more interested. You know, to close this on a positive note, AJ Foyt made a couple of statements earlier today. He's out of the hospital recovering. He wants to be ready to go before the Indy 500. And after that triple bypass surgery that he had just over the off season and all the complications for the couple weeks he was in the hospital, it's good to hear that he's doing well. I like that bit of news. And I'm hoping that old AJ does get back up on the pit box or at least out in the paddock for the month of May, because the 500 is not the 500 without Foyt being there.
No, it's not. He's been having some complications after triple bypass heart surgery in November, and clearly he's frustrated, but he is a fiery personality. We know he's got fight on and off the track, and I think that certainly applies here. He really wants to get back up on the box, get to the track soon. And you know something? Even for a guy who turns 80 years old this Friday, I have no doubts he'll be able to do that. I think this means so much to him, and he means so much to this sport, that everything he's brought here couldn't be any more thankful. AJ, my thoughts are with you. Everybody's thoughts are with you, and we hope to see you back at the track soon.
And Tom, you know what? Joel brings up an interesting point. If anybody had told AJ Foyt about three decades ago that he'd see 80, they probably would have gotten a pretty fiery answer at that point.
Well, you know, he's too stubborn not to still be hanging around. He's as tough as nails, old Super Tex is. And, you know, it's good that he's on the road to recovery. And, you know, I think that his team has got a chance this year to really be fun to watch with, you know, the two cars now. And I really, really want to see a big season from that group. You know, IndyCar racing is better for AJ Foyt still being in it and being relevant and being a part of it, just the same way that NASCAR is for Richard Petty still being in there. Yes. And even though, you know, it isn't truly his team anymore, the fact that he's still the ambassador and able to be, you know, be in and be a part of it. So I hope that, I hope they have a great season this year, and I hope AJ is able to get back to the track soon.
Yes, and Joel, we appreciate you sliding on tonight for a double feature here. We're looking forward to having you back next Monday and maybe find some more news. It'll be fun. You and Tom can argue, and we'll look forward to it. And I'll go find you some cheese and crackers.
Go for it. Don't forget the wine. Thanks as always.
Hey, he can have it. He turned 21 over the weekend, that's too. Right. So happy late birthday, Joel. Race.
Thank you.
We're going to take a break here. We'll be back going dirt track, and Steve Ovens joins us in just a few moments right here on the Performance Motorsports Network.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
WinYourNewCar.com. Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at WinYourNewCar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free. Come on, stop dreaming. Start driving with WinYourNewCar.com.
You hear that? That's the sound of America's only sports car. That's right, it's a Corvette. But not just any Corvette, it's your Corvette. It's that who cares if there's traffic part of your day. And this can be you when you come to Cooper Corvettes. With 60 years of Corvettes to choose from, there's always a Corvette in your budget. And they'll service any Corvette you bring in. Cooper Corvettes, on Route 1 just north of Quantico and Triangle. Call, click, or visit CooperCorvettes.com.
Hi, this is Yen Scott from Summit Point Kart in Summit Point, West Virginia. If you're looking for a real racing experience on a real racetrack, come out to Summit Point Kart this weekend. For as little as $25, you can get your racing career started. New this year, Summit Point Kart offers the RX250 capable of over 75 miles an hour. We're open every Friday from 5 p.m. till 9 p.m., Saturday from noon till 10 p.m., and Sunday from noon till 9 p.m. For more information, go to our website, summitpointkartwithak.com, or you can call us at 304-725-5270. Summit Point Kart, your East Coast karting center.
In the race of everyday life, it's nice to have the green flag, but drivetrain problems are the pits. A fully remanufactured engine, transmission, or differential from Jasper Engines and Transmissions costs less than a new vehicle and comes with a 3-year, 100,000-mile nationwide transferable warranty. See JasperEngines.com for details and get the green flag in your race of everyday life.
See the boys at Chandler & Sons Automotive, 45977 Old Ox Road in Sterling. Give them a call, 703-437-7300.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration.
Packers.
Vikings.
Red State.
Blue State.
We come from different places.
Uptown.
Downtown.
We come to different conclusions.
Half empty.
Half full.
But no matter how different we are, we're all connected, and we can all make a difference. That's why United Way brings people, expertise, and resources together to improve the education, income, and health of our communities, the building blocks for a better life. When we live united, our efforts, magnified by others, add up to real change. Children succeed in school, families gain financial stability, the health of our neighbors improves, and suddenly, so do our communities. But real change won't happen without you.
Live united.
So let's look beyond our differences.
Live united.
One by one, let's make a difference. Let's reach out a hand to one and influence the condition of all.
Live united.
Give, advocate, volunteer. Live United. Sign up today at liveunited.org. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
Hi, the kids. It's time to get dirty on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness. Here are your hosts, Jacob, Tom, and Kyle, with Turn 5 Live's curator of Casa de Pork Chop, Stephen Oven.
The doctor is in the house. Welcome back to Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, and our own version of Dr. Dirt. Steve Ovens joins us now from New York to talk a little bit of everything. We've got New York, we've got National, we've got Steve, we're spending more time on the West Coast tonight in your segment than I think we have in a year.
Oh, for sure. Other than when the Outlaws head out west for their California swing, we don't get to talk about the West Coast too much, but glad to do it tonight as winter heat wrapped up here just the other night.
Let's dig right into this, Steve, because it was crazy. This was a great five-race swing at Kokopa Speedway for the Winter Heat Sprint Car Showdown. I had fun just being able to follow it. Speed Sport Productions doing a nice job with their videography of that event, and it was just fun to watch. I mean, you've got Danny Lasoski performing at such a high level. Aaron Reutzel winning the final night after four nights being so tough to him. And hail to the king, Steve Kinzer won a race.
Well, you know, you look at the event as a whole and, you know, five different winners in five nights. I think that just goes to show the kind of event that these guys were trying to put on and, you know, bringing the best of the best in an event that, you know, I think for years to come now is going to kick off the season. Now, certainly there were drivers that had made their plans to race in Australia prior to Winter Heat Sprint Car Showdown being announced. But going forward, I would fully expect to see some drivers that you didn't see this year make the drive down to Yuma, Arizona in the future. But yeah, you talk about Steve Kinzer getting a win and how big that was, Danny Lasoski getting a win, and how big that was, Reutzel getting a win after the front wing collapsed late in the going. You know, he made it back by Craig Delansky to take the lead, and then the front wing collapses, and had that wing collapsed prior to him taking the lead, I don't think we would be talking about Reutzel getting a win there at Kokopa. And let's not overshadow the fact, you know, we talked about it last week here on the Madness, Kyle Larson getting a win, as well as Paul McMahon. For each one of these guys, this was huge wins to get 2015 started for those guys.
Oh, it was absolutely huge. And it was just, I don't think I've seen any better sprint car racing, at least in recent memory, Steve, out on the West Coast. This is exactly what we needed. We needed some good old winter sprint car racing on American soil instead of going overseas. And they've already announced that this deal is going to be back for 2016 as well. And some guy named Tony Stewart is a little excited about that. I seem to have heard that name a time or two somewhere.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think that getting that announcement out quickly gives people the opportunity to make their plans to come back to Yuma next January in 2016. And, you know, the other thing, too, is I want to give a tip of the cap to all of the folks. We talked about how great the racing was there at Kokopa. I want to tip my cap to all the guys working on the track, because those guys had three distinct lines that they could use each and every night trying to, you know, I mean, how many racetracks put on five events in a matter of 8 to 9 days? Not too many, other than if you think of the Knoxville Nationals or an event of that caliber. But, you know, the track conditions to give those guys so many distinct lines to run. You know, the night that Lasoski won, that move, you know, he used the middle, the top, and the bottom at all different points of the night, working his way through the top five. So just incredible racing, and congratulations to each and every one of those guys picking up wins.
And here, I'll combine two subjects now that are two of your favorite subjects, dirt track racing and food. Guess what, Steve? The Chili Bowl's tomorrow.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think the nation's supply of kidney beans, Ritz crackers, And certainly shredded Parmesan cheese is going to be a little bit bare in the store shelves this week.
Just a little bit.
Well,
now, only here on the Madness can you talk about dirt track racing, kidney beans, Ritz crackers, and shredded cheese.
All in the same sentence.
And, of course, we have the wine that has to go along with that, too, even though it's not Joel's segment anymore.
Absolutely. But, yeah, so, you know, you talk about the Chili Bowl this week. You know, this is the week, once a year, every year, where everybody's social media gets blown up with pictures, videos, promotions of things happening at the Chili Bowl. One guy that I've been kind of watching today on social media was Glenn Stiers, owner of the Ashwican Speedway. He is running with a team that, of course, his Speedway is a contributing sponsor. So you've got he'll be racing with that team, J.J. Yaley, as well. And he posted some pretty cool videos today of practice. And, after watching that, I had two observations, and they were both with J.J. Yaley's practice session. Number one, J.J. Yaley has got himself a stove underneath the hood of that ride. And number two, they've got some work to do on their setup because J.J. went for a loop in turn three during his practice session. They've got a little bit of work to do on that car, but believe me, come Saturday, or, you know, this week they'll have their qualifying events, but, you know, come Saturday when it's time for the Alphabet Soup and the A-Main, those guys will have that car tuned right up.
Well, I would imagine they will, and of course, with a field the size of the entry field for the Chili Bowl and all of the racing that has to go on this week in order to get to Saturday's finals, I mean, I don't know how they somehow they managed to stretch this out to almost an entire week and still make it relevant. That's pretty doggone cool, and it's so relevant that, Steve, we're going to ask you just to sit tight. We're going to continue with you right into the next segment, talk about some Chili Bowl, talk about what's going on in New York. So if you would, just hang on for a couple, and we will continue with more of Motorsports Madness here on the Performance Motorsports Network right after this.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
Enter America's number one dream car giveaway contest at winyournewcar.com. That's right, winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming and start driving with winyournewcar.com.
We're growing like crazy and need account reps who know their way around agencies, the internet, and social media. Got connections? Or do you know how to get to the decision makers? Are you fearless? We need you. Internet radio, or as we call it, wireless mobile radio, is rapidly becoming the place to be with almost limitless income potential. So contact us to get involved with the fastest growing professionally produced group of internet radio stations in the world. Your imagination is the only limit here. Call 717-749-0444. That's 717-749-0444. Or you can email us at scorpionradiogroup@gmail.com. You want to ask for Sue.
So you finally arrived at the sweet spot in your life. The kids are raised and gone. You have free time, and it's finally time to do something for you. If you've ever considered owning a Corvette but have been putting it off for years, now is the time to act. Isn't this the time to finally get that Corvette you always wanted and drooled and dreamed over? Well, grab the little lady by the hand and take her to Cooper Corvettes. They're conveniently located on Route 1 just off of I-95 and just north of the Marine Corps base. They have lots of pampered and well-maintained Corvettes in inventory, and if they don't have what you want, they'll find it. From classic Stingrays to modern-day cars, Cooper is your one-stop shop. And speaking of shops, they service what they sell. And even if you didn't buy a Cooper Corvette, they'll service your Corvette anyway. Become part of the Cooper Corvette family. Call them at 703-445-1483. That's 703-445-1483. And on the web at coopercorvettes.com. That's coopercorvettes.com, American pride and countrywide.
You wouldn't trust your taxes to an uncertified accountant. So why trust your vehicle to an uncertified technician? When you have to take your car into the shop, look for the blue and white ASE sign. That ASE blue seal means the shop employs technicians certified by the National Institute for Automotive Service Excellence. ASE certification is proof that technicians have the knowledge and experience to fix your vehicle right the first time. For more information on finding an ASE blue seal of excellence facility, visit the website at www.ase.com.
Hi, this is Carl Edwards here for RAD, the entertainment industry's voice for road safety. You want to make a difference? It's simple. Be responsible. Plan ahead. Designate before you celebrate. Friends don't let friends drive drunk.
Maybe you can drive my car. Yes, I'm gonna be a star.
A public service message brought to you by the U.S. Department of Transportation, RAD, the National Association of Broadcasters, and the Ad Council.
We now return you to 2.5 Men on Speed 77 Radio's Motorsports Madness on the Performance Motorsports Network.
We're back, and you know what? I count 3.5 because, you know, we've got Steve, too, so that just helps. But welcome back to Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Steve Ovens, Kyle Magda here around the round table. That's not implying, Kyle, that you're the half necessarily, just, you know, that the universe is not quite broken enough yet. So we'll get there later. But Steve, back to dirt track talk here.
Easy for you.
Wow. Apparently, no, it's not. But okay, so Chili Bowl. We'll get to picks and such things here in a couple of minutes. But it's the Golden Driller. It's the biggest prize in dirt track racing that's not named the Knoxville Nationals. Everybody and their brother comes out for this race. And I'll go back to a line that Tony Stewart once famously used on the pavement. It's true. You might just wreck your mother to win this race.
Well, that's absolutely true, and I think years ago, the saying was you might wreck your brother to win that race. You know, there was a race back, and we're talking years ago, that you saw just that happen. But yeah, that's exactly a great line to preview the Chili Bowl. It's the race that everybody wants to go out and win in a midget, and I think the entries speak for themselves. You have, you know, roughly 325 entries, give or take an entry here or there, and only 24 of them are going to start the A main on Saturday. That just gives you an idea of what kind of hype and hype for all the right reasons this event has. You know, the guys are going to be dicing it up on their qualifying nights, because the key is you got to get out of your qualifying night to get to that A main on Saturday. You do not want to be stuck in the H main to try and qualify your way up through. We were talking last week on Turn 5 Live about, you know, how far we realistically think somebody could come from the alphabet soup to get themselves qualified in, and it was kind of a mixed bag. Some guys thought you needed to be at least in the B main to have a chance. I, on the other hand, think that you could do it from the C main, but you're going to have to start up toward the front if you're going to do it.
If your last name is Swindell, I'm pretty sure you can come from about the E main to make it. But other than that, yeah, I think C's the external limit, and realistically, probably the B. And, you know, talking about Swindells, Tom just poked me and asked me a good point, Steve, and I'll toss it to you. We were talking about wrecking mothers and wrecking brothers to win the Chili Bowl. Would Sammy wreck Kevin to win this race?
I think Sammy would wreck Sammy to win this race. To be honest with you, Kevin, let's just throw it out there.
I know Kevin would wreck Sammy to win.
Well, and what a feat, you know, for either of them to win that race. What a feat it would be. I think for Sammy it would be number 6, and for Kevin it could be number 5.
Yeah, that's exactly the right numbers. If Kevin wins the Chili Bowl this weekend, Tom, he ties his father with most Chili Bowl wins ever. Ever.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing, honestly, that those two have had such a stronghold on that event. And it's so inexplainable, because when you start with 250 or 300 plus entries, to have one group that just has won, what, 9 times? I mean, that's just beyond all explanation. It defies logic, to be honest. But, boy, they just know the way around the place, I guess. But the amount of luck that has to come into play in order to have a bunch of wins like that in a race like this with the format it has is just, it's really amazing. I would really love to to calculate the odds of two cars over a, you know, 10 or 12 year, whatever it's been, period, having 9 wins in the event. It's pretty amazing.
Uh-huh. Just a little bit. And Steve, some guy named Clausen snapped that run that old Kevin had going last year. And you know what? This isn't a 2-inch limb when there's two Swindells in this race. So I'm just going to go I'm going to go out and say it. I think Brian Clausen is going to be the first guy since a Swindell to go back to back, only the second guy ever to do it.
Well, that very well could happen. I'm not going to say that won't happen, but I feel like there are so many strong contenders that I think he's going to have an awfully hard time pulling that feat off. Now, if he does it, that won't surprise me, but I just think there's so many competitors. I mean, you look at the team of Christopher Bell, Kyle Larson, and Rico Abreu. I mean, that's a powerhouse team right there that, you know, if any of those guys won, you could also say that wouldn't be a huge surprise because they are so talented. And to be honest with you, you know, if I had anybody in the field, I think I would pick one of those three guys right there. Now, you know, if you're going to nail me down to a pick, I would want to try and pick somebody from outside of that group. But boy, they're awfully hard to look away from.
Yeah, Tom, I forgot some kid named Larson was in this race.
Well, it's a little hard to forget. And guys like Chris Bell and Rico Abreu, you know, we get lost. Everybody gets so lost talking about the Swindells and Brian Clausen and even some of the other past winners that, you know, here again. But there's so many capable drivers in this race. In fact, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the aforementioned Cole Custer is running this race, isn't he?
No.
I thought I saw where he was. I thought I actually saw where he was entered. I might be wrong, but I thought I saw something on Facebook earlier where he was running it. I mean, it's just
I'm going to look it up.
There are
Tom,
so
yeah, I don't have it in front of me, Tom, drivers. But I think you are onto something there. I do remember seeing that name other than the announcement today.
Yeah, we'll check on that because I thought I saw something on Facebook just a little while ago with a picture of him and talking about how he was entered in the race and hasn't run much recently in the sprint car or whatever. But I we'll have to look. But at any rate, there's so many capable drivers in the event. I mean, when you talk about a field of 300 cars, and I mean, realistically, if you were to lay odds, you would say, okay, maybe a quarter of the field, probably realistically or less, has a chance to really win the race. And then a quarter of those guys would be the odds on favorites. That's still probably 30 or 40 drivers. So again, it's survival early in the week, but you also have to be fast. And then, of course, when you get to Saturday, it's just every man for himself. There's no patience whatsoever. It's just get it to the front and go.
Son of a gun. You two were actually onto something. Cole Custer is running tomorrow night on Tuesday night's qualifying night. Son of a gun.
There you go.
What a week for that young man right there.
Really?
Yeah, get the truck ride with Junior and go on his way to the Chili Bowl. Son of a gun.
Next thing you know, Junior Motorsports will have a team for the Chili Bowl next year.
Don't put ideas in anybody's head. Next thing you know, Junior will be running at the Chili Bowl.
I bet Junior would have a ball doing that.
The headline now. Junior and Mike Davis in midgets for the Chili Bowl.
Yes. Oh, dear.
Good stuff, gentlemen. Good stuff.
Yeah, I'm rather excited about that. Now, tomorrow night's qualifying night is going to be fun, Steve. Cole Custer, Brad Loyette, Sammy Swindell, J.J. Yaley, we mentioned him, Mike Wheeler, who won the Sweet Sport Challenge back in May, Ryan Bernal, Nathan Benson, Shane Cottle, good grief, the list goes on and on, Caleb Armstrong, and that's not even halfway down the list. I mean, you sit here and look at this and go, wait. This is the end all to end all dirt track races. Even Kenny Wallace is running.
Well, it's going to be fun to watch him because I don't think that Kenny's entered this race before. And Kenny is one of those guys that I don't know about everybody else, but I just enjoy following whatever Kenny's doing. And you know, is another one of those dirt guys that. You know, we need that kind of guy out there supporting dirt tracks across the country, and we need that spokesperson because if we know anything about Kenny, we know he's a spokesperson.
Oh, that he is. That he is. Well, Steve, I tell you what, dirt has been fun. I know there's more dirt to come tomorrow night on Turn 5 Live, so we're looking forward to that. And, hey, some Grit Racing Series group, we're a little excited about them, too. I know that's a big part of tomorrow night.
Yeah, it is. We're actually going to kick off the show tomorrow night with Nick Stark from the Grit Racing Series to help us talk about the new partnership between the Grit Racing Series, Race Chaser Online, and Turn 5 Live becoming the official media outlet for the Grit Racing Series. Pretty exciting deal there. That is a Sportsman Dirt Modified Series that is up and coming, getting ready to start their third season of action this year. They've actually have grown to the point where in 2015 they'll be splitting into a North and South Series. So we're going to talk a little bit about that, what that means for the drivers. Certainly the announcement of Utica Rome Speedway going to Hoosier Tires in 2015, that has a big impact on sportsman drivers as well. And, that is just going to be, you know, in addition to the fact that Utica Rome announced that they're going to have open sportsmen as well as the 602 GM Crate Sportsman Division.
Yes.
In 2015. That has a really big impact on the Grit Series, and Nick is going to talk to us about that tomorrow night.
We're looking forward to it, and we appreciate the time, Steve. And we know Dr. Dirt will be keeping an eye on all things Chili Bowl and eating some chili, too. So we'll catch up with you tomorrow night and then see you next Monday to break it all down and find out who took a golden driller back home.
All right, boys. Saturday night, you guys bring the crackers.
And we'll all sit and watch it on MAV TV. Going to take a couple of minutes here and do some business. And when we come back, we'll talk sports cars, legend cars, and get ready to throw a checkered flag. It's Motorsports Madness, and we're rolling to the finish line right after this on the Performance Motorsports Network.
If you're a gearhead, you probably go online to those hot rod superstores, drooling over the chrome and speed goodies until you find just the right item for your muscle car, tuner car, truck. But what do you do when it comes to fixing the mom mobile? If you're like most do-it-yourselfers, you head to the strip mall parts store and talk to the "Do you want fries with that?" kid behind the counter. Hold on, Bunky. Did you stop to think where those chain stores are getting the parts that you're installing in the vehicle that's used to transport your family everywhere? They get the cheapest suppliers they can find to sell you the parts at bargain prices. Their limited lifetime warranties? What a joke. Remember the last time mom's car broke down? You heard about that one for weeks. Don't take that chance again. Excelsior Racing has the quality parts you need for your family vehicle. Parts that you can install knowing you're getting the best for your family. Excelsior Racing. Quality parts. Personalized service. Affordable pricing. Fast to you direct. Excelsior Racing. Online at ExcelsiorRacing.com or call 502-909-2034.
How would you like to win a brand new Corvette? Larry O's got all the details.
In the Pits Media is proud to present its newest partner, winyournewcar.com. That's right, you now can enter the number one American dream car contest giveaway at winyournewcar.com. Complete the puzzle the fastest and win a new Corvette tax-free delivered to your door. Come on, stop dreaming, start driving with winyournewcar.com.
Did you know that birthday parties help build confidence in kids?
Yeah. Did you know that giving kids less sugar before bedtime helps them sleep better?
Oh, totally. Did you know that friendly kids have more friends?
Everybody knows that.
Hey, guys, did you know that most people think they're using the right car seat for their kid, but they're not?
I didn't know that.
Parents who really know it all know for sure that their child is in the right car seat at the right age and size. Visit safercar.gov/the right seat to make sure your child is protected. Brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration and the Ad Council.
Hands can do incredible things. They made every sound in this piece of music. But nothing compares to using them to help save a life. If an adult suddenly collapses, call 911, then push hard and fast in the center of their chest until help arrives. It's called hands-only CPR, and it's recommended by the American Heart Association. Visit handsonlycpr.org today. A message from the American Heart Association and the Ad Council.
Car problems? You can trust your local Cottman man. Cottman has a 40-year history as a leader in car repair and making happy, satisfied customers. Whatever's wrong with your car, SUV, or truck, Cottman will check it out free using state-of-the-art diagnostic equipment. Don't take chances with your car. Bring it to Cottman and let your local Cottman man show you why they are America's transmission and total auto care experts. Visit Cottman.com to download money-saving coupons. Cottman, real service, real fast.
You know that phone call is going to come at the worst possible time, right at the end of the game. Fourth quarter, fourth down, and 1 yard to go. They're piling up, but you can't watch that. You got to get that car off the road. This could have been prevented if you have taken advantage of Cottman's free TransCheck 21. Here's a chance to have us look at your car and head off any problems that could happen that could interrupt that game. Again, it's a free check. Come see us.
See Leonard and the fine folks at Cottman of Manassas, 9113 Mathis Avenue in Manassas. Give them a call at 703-365-7200.
All I wanted to do was just pick up a guitar and sing praise songs.
From IamSecond.com.
Well, when I got to 17, I was playing in after-hours bars, just in a bunch of trouble.
Grammy Award winner Michael W. Smith.
Smoking that first joint and feeling so guilty about it. From there, it was LSD, and your compass sort of just like disappeared. I knew where I belonged. I just couldn't get out. I was very depressed. I went on the floor and just began to shake. And I was just weeping. I was weeping. And I just began to just cry out for God. 12:30 at night, on the linoleum floor of my kitchen, the God of the universe came and wept with me on that floor. I know where my hope lies. It's not being a rock star. I'm a son of the High King of the universe.
Watch Michael's story at IamSecond.com.
You're listening to Speed 77 Radio on the Performance Motorsports Network. Now back to Jacob, Tom, and Kyle on Motorsports Madness.
That's right. We're back here at the roundtable on Motorsports Madness. Jacob Seelman, Tom Baker, Kyle Magda, and time to start our last lap segment, Tom. And, you know, before we get to all the way to the checkered flag, I can think of at least a few more things that we just got to talk about, because you mentioned a race that's coming up at the top of the show here in a couple weeks, and it's some race that goes 24 hours and runs at some pretty famous racetrack in Florida. And, oh, by the way, Jordan Taylor was fastest in the overall prototype class. Yes, that means it's time for the Rolex 24, and I'm excited because, granted, I'm going to miss the beginning of it due to the USCS Sprint Car Banquet being on the same day. This is one of my favorite events of the year because you get to sit, watch racing for as long as you want, go to bed, wake up, there's more racing, and it's just so drama-filled. I mean, you've got pit stops over 24 hours, driver changes, some of the best of the best of the best in road course racing history all involved in this. You've got the ringers that come over from NASCAR, IndyCar, you name it, Tom. And for the American homeboys, Jordan and Ricky Taylor, to be on top of the charts early, you know, those two haven't won a Rolex together. In fact, I don't think either one of them has a 24-hour watch. So for the brothers, they want to get it done. They got outsmarted a couple years in a row now. And that Wayne Taylor Racing team, they're pumped, and they were really quick.
Yeah, they really were. And it occurs to me that this may be the only one of the only nights of the year that you don't mind a temporary case of insomnia.
Yes.
Just, it really is a great day, as you said, just to sit back and just enjoy some racing. And even if you're kind of splitting your attention, to have the race just go on through the day and evening and be able to just look in on it when you want. And yeah, I mean, there's no question that, I mean, the Taylors are definitely quick, but I'll tell you that the team I'm keeping my eye on is the Ganassi team with Sage Karam. I haven't seen Sage, the posts on Instagram and social media that Sage has been, I mean, he just is totally excited about this. And I think he feels a sense of confidence that he didn't have last year because it was all new to him. But this is a young man that really has proven his ability as a racer who can race the wheels off of anything he gets in. I mean, from a go-kart to, you know, indie style cars, now to the sports car. And honestly, wouldn't surprise me if someday he got a shot in some sort of a NASCAR type car at some point for Chip. But I'm really going to be interested to see how that team does and just how that turns out. But yeah, I mean, with the stuff that's going on now with Delta Wing and just all of the, you know, all of the changes that have been made and you know, new faces, new places, it's going to be really exciting to watch that.
Well, let's talk new faces and new places for a minute and see if we can do this without breaking the universe, Kyle Magda. We'll bring you in on this because Tom was so caught up in the whole Sage Karam conversation, he forgets that car is the one that also has Scott Pruitt and Joey Hand in it. Where's Memo Rojas, you ask? Well, that other car that Tom mentioned, the Delta Wing, yeah, they picked him up. And Tim Keen, the old sports car manager at Ganassi Racing in the sports car program until, what, I think it was the end of 2013. Those two are back together again. And I've heard a lot of people saying that the Delta Wing could actually be really, really competitive this year.
For sure. And I won't use my bad Joey Hand joke again tonight. I promise you that. But
good.
Yeah, you know, they're just so, you know, like we say, Ganassi is so stacked. Having the two teams, the 01 and the 02, there's just so many good drivers on that team. Yeah, Tony Kanaan, I think Jamie McMurray might be running it again. Carl Larson, Sage Karam, the list just goes on. And like you said, Jacob, that Delta Wing team, they could contend. I mean, Memo Rojas has all that experience that he had with Ganassi, and that is definitely a positive for that Delta Wing team. So. I know there's still a lot of other teams. The Star Wars team, they were fast in the whole Roar Before the 24 thing. So there's a lot of teams. And keep in mind, guys, it's not being the fastest in the beginning. It's being there in the end.
Yep,
and to
absolutely.
Make it throughout the night. Because I've seen in years past, I've seen fast cars dominate the race and not go on to win. Just because you have to be there for all 24 hours of the race. To go in. I think the closest the race has ever been was that year. I think it was 2009 with David Donahue and the Brumos Porsche team passing. I think it was Juan Pablo Montoya for the final pass, and I think it won by about 2 seconds. So it's been close like that. And then you have, I think, 2013, you had the 0-1 team dominate the whole race. And I have never seen a car that dominant ever in the Rolex 24. So there's so many things that could happen throughout the night and so many variables. So you just have to be there in the end to win it, and you know, like I said, you got the fastest car, and just you need to be there in the end and survive throughout the night to have a shot at winning.
Yeah, I mean, and how many times have we seen the Ganassi cars be so good only to be undone by some freak mechanical failure? It happened actually last year to Scott Pruitt during the middle of the night, and then even to the 02 late in the going as the sun was coming up. So nobody's immune in this race, and that's why we see some surprise winners going even back to 2003 when Tony Stewart was leading with 17 minutes to go and they had a tire go down or something like that, Tom, and they didn't end up winning. I mean, we've seen it all in this race.
Yeah, we really have, and that's why it's so amazing, because there, you obviously have a strategy. And as Kyle said, the strategy is to survive to the end and make sure that you've got all your stuff intact and that you can save a little bit of race car for the stretch run. But there to have 23 and a half hours or so to get through before you get to that final run is, it really, there's nothing else like it. And so it's a completely different type of race every year, it seems. You know, some races have a lot of, you know, wrecks or long, you know, periods of red flag, periods of caution. And some races have very little, you know, that gets in the way of the green flag action. And there are very long runs without any incidents at all. So it's really a race that nobody can completely master, I think, because of that. And I think that's why it's so hard for any one organization. I mean, Ganassi's probably the organization you'd say that's had the best, the best overall hold on the race, if you will, in recent times.
But yeah, they absolutely have. I mean, they've got five wins in a 7-year span, and the other 2 years they didn't win, they finished second.
Yeah, but I mean, even still, though, it wasn't as if there weren't other teams in contention. It just comes down to, you know, something falls off or just bad luck or, you know, getting caught in something. I don't think it's a race because of the way it plays out and the fact that it's different every year. I don't think it's a race that you can say anybody truly dominates. It's just that Ganassi's been very, very good at enduring that endurance event, and it's not even so much about them being unstoppable or nobody being able to race with them, but it's really amazing that they've even gotten 5 out of 7 with the type of luck that it takes. It's kind of like what we were talking about with the Chili Bowl. There's so much to get through before the end that it's just unbelievable to have that kind of a record.
And guys, keep in mind, this is the same race where Max Pappas got his famous Mad Max nickname as well. So I think he was. I think he was 13 laps down in the race, and he almost came back to win the whole entire thing. I think that's the story. So
there's just some number like that.
Yeah, it's just something like that. But that's how, you know, him. And then of course, you know, running all the series, IndyCar, NASCAR, and everything. So. Yeah, guys, like you said, that the Rolex 24, there's just so many storylines going into it. I mean, you've seen Sprint Cup Series champions run it. I've seen everybody run it. Even the late Paul Newman run that race. I think
he
won
was
it,
a
actually.
Good racer.
I think he won it. He might have won it with Mark Martin in 1995. So, he has some experience, and of course, with the IndyCar team. But there's just so much history with that race, and that it goes back. It's just, you know, it's one of those crown jewel events that you have to look at every single season.
Oh, you absolutely do, and it's one that we're going to be keep looking at until the checkered flag falls after the clock hits zero at about 3 p.m. on that Sunday afternoon. But, Tom, before we close, I can think of one more moment that I want to hit on. And, you know, you and I had a fun weekend, even if we were freezing our little tails off at Charlotte Motor Speedway to find us some racing over the weekend. But I want to give a shout-out to the moment of the weekend, in my opinion, at Charlotte. Masters Division Legends Car Racing, Bruce Silver finally gets a win after, goodness, I don't even know how many years he's come to Charlotte trying to race in
a lot.
Race. Yeah, a lot. We won't date him too bad.
Yeah,
but
more than he would want us to tell.
Hi-ho, because that
hi-ho
was
Silver.
Yes, that was just one of those moments that made me grin so much this weekend. It was great. Bruce was ecstatic, and he backed it up with a third-place finish on Sunday afternoon, too. I loved it. Any other final thoughts from you? I mean, you and I were both grinning about that.
Well, I'm just going to expand on that a little bit. I mean, I've known Bruce for a while, and of course, for those who don't know, Bruce Silver owns Racing Electronics, which is one of the leading radio communications suppliers in the motorsports industry, and he is just the nicest guy you'd ever want to meet. He's so friendly and just really is so passionate about the sport, and he just loves the Legends car racing, and really does it just for the fun of it. But you know, for him to get a win at Charlotte Motor Speedway is huge for him, and it's a big deal. And something that, you know, now he'll remember that for the rest of his life, even if he never does it again. And so it's one of those times when the good guy prevails, and you can walk away no matter what else happened that day. You can walk away and just say, you know what, I'm glad that he was able to have that moment. That's what racing's all about. Kyle Magna?
You know, there's just so much to think over the weekend, and like you guys said, even though you froze your butts off in the cold, I mean, you know, it's a sport of racing. I mean, I did that at the Turkey Derby, even though I was in a heated trailer for most of the day, but that's just me, because there's no meat on my bones. So, there's just so much to look forward to this season. I know I keep saying that, and I know in one of my articles I mentioned that. There's just so much going on. So, looking forward to the Rolex 24, and like I said, for me, hopefully the motorsport show in Philadelphia in a few weeks, and then maybe possibly Atlantic City at the end of the month.
And hey, there's so much going on. We keep talking about racing, and I'll throw one more thought at you. Go Ducks!
Well, you know what? I'm kind of cheering for Ohio State. I'm cheering for the Buckeyes tonight, but I got Oregon 38-34. We'll see.
Two words, Marcus Mariota.
Okay, we'll see what happens. But right now, I say we throw a checkered flag on this edition of Motorsports Madness, and I'm going to watch some football. I don't know about you guys. So for all of us here tonight at the round table, Joel Sebastianelli, Steve Ovens, Kyle Magda, and of course, my partner in crime, Tom Baker. Special thanks to Cameron Haley, Spencer Davis for coming on and joining us on tonight's show. We appreciate their time. And until next Monday, right back here on the Performance Motorsports Network, 7 p.m. Eastern is the time. Right here is the place. I'm Jacob Seelman. Keep it off the wall until we meet again, and we'll see you possibly at the racetrack. Good night.
You've been listening to Motorsports Madness with the Speed 77 Radio Race Chaser Online crew. Stay tuned to Performance Motorsports Network for more race talk. For the latest motorsports news, visit racechaseronline.com. Motorsports Madness is a copyrighted production of the Performance Motorsports Network. www.performancemotorsportsnetwork.com, a member of the Scorpion Radio Group, Inc., and may not be rebroadcast, replicated, or saved in any media without the explicit written permission of PMN. Check out our Facebook page or our section on the PMN website. The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host, co-host, and guests, and do not necessarily reflect those of the management and ownership of either the Performance Motorsports Network or Scorpion Radio Group Incorporated, the advertisers, or the marketing partners. Be listening again next week when the madness returns on Monday night at 7 Eastern. Until then, keep it off the wall and keep the shiny side up.